Coming up on WRAL-TV News at 6, damage estimates continue to roll in after the wrath of yesterday's early morning tornado.
Families sort through the rubble and salvage what they can as the cleanup continues.
And it's a fun and final goodbye to an old friend, one of WRAL-TV's own. WRAL-TV News is next.
WRAL-TV, Raleigh, Durham, Fayetteville. From WRAL-TV, Charlie Gaddy, Adele Arakawa, Bob DeBardelaben, and Tom Suter with North Carolina's leading news team. This is WRAL-TV News.
I wonder if this track is continuous all the way up to... Halifax County.
From a Sky 5 view, an expert traces the path of yesterday's tornado. It was a trip that revealed a lot about the nature and the force of that storm. Good evening. It is day two of the tornado story. People are digging out. Damage estimates are going higher. Plans for recovery are being laid out. Tonight, we're going to share all of that with you. But our first story has to do with the storm itself and Dave Eichhorn. And Dave, you had an unusual trip today, did you not?
I sure did, Charlie. You know, I've been up in various aircraft, been up in Sky 5 a few times. This time we went up to take a look at the tornado damage. And as we went along, we found ourselves traveling a great distance. In fact, well, if I take you back to the other morning when we were in the weather center, Greg and I were both in there working. And we've got the latest equipment in regard to computers, radars, satellite photographs and stuff. But even though you have that equipment and you're inside, you just can't see, you just can't comprehend or conceive how horrible things really are going on outside when this damage is taking place.
The Weather Service at RDU up into Sky 5 for a look. What is most remarkable about this storm, besides its vast destruction, was that the path didn't stop. We flew on, and the damage kept appearing. It was one tornado from I-40 deep into Franklin County, a 33-mile-long path. We all know it was a tornado, but it's not confirmed until the damage is checked by the National Weather Service. There was a lot we discovered.
We have difficulty really determining the width of the storm until we can get up and look at it from the air.
Most obvious is debris scattered in many directions. Large swaths of trees lying in one direction, and then in another.
Looking at the damage path and the length to width ratio, there's certainly no doubt that it was tornadic. We might, as we travel the path, find some areas of downburst wind to either side of the track. We'll just have to keep our eyes out.
Houses seemingly picked from a group, and then some damage just totally indiscriminate. At times, the damage path was nearly 300 yards wide, and at other times, only 50 to 100 feet. The twister skipped at times, hopping over things, and then landing furiously, ripping up all structure in its way.
It's a rough situation, really. The storm system, and looking at everything that I saw going up in Sky 5, it humbles you very much, Charlie.
I started to say, how did it affect you to fly over 31 miles of devastation like that?
Well, it sort of reminds me of my first trip into Colorado when we were going up towards one of the really higher passes, and we came around a corner, and we came up against a rock ledge that was so huge that you had to lean forward to look out the windshield to see it. It made me feel small. And you look at a situation like this, and with all of our money, with all of our technology, man hours, and energy, we build things as big as the biggest buildings you can find, and then in a minute, it can be gone like that. And to think that this went on for 31, 33 miles is very, very humbling.
Thank you for sharing that with us, Dave. Adele?
All right, Charlie, thank you. More than 800 people are without homes after all these storms. Many are covered by insurance, but is that really enough? Dennis Edwards is standing by with a report on whether victims will get federal emergency assistance. Dennis?
Well, Adele, survival isn't the only issue on a lot of people's minds at this point. As you can tell behind me here, people survived this situation. It was very rough on them. But they're wondering right now whether or not the federal government will help them get back on their feet. Teams of federal and state emergency people are working on an answer to that question. They spent the day walking through ruined neighborhoods, looking at the severity of the damage. Their decision will depend on the extent of damage and how much insurance victims have, but federal assistance isn't the only option.
69 minor Basically, you have a presidential declaration which will take into consideration all the federal programs that come into play, as well as the states. If it isn't declared a presidential declaration, it still could be declared an SBA declaration, where people could be eligible to loan money.
Well, the state and federal emergency people are hoping to have an answer for folks here in North Carolina tomorrow afternoon. That's when they hope to let state officials know whether people who are victims of devastation like this here behind me will get a chance to get some help from the federal government. Adele, Charlie?
Thank you, Dennis. The storm brought damage almost too big for the small screen to show, but it is damage that homeowners must begin cleaning up, and today as they got to work, they found help from a variety of unexpected sources. Leslie Boney has that story.
North Raleigh the day after. Strollers bumping along pine-strewn streets. TV antennas mangled into modern art. Dogwoods with late autumn blooms of insulation. Blue skies above blown-out windows. Amid the absurdity, there is hope. Local builders are donating time and materials. The guys in the white hats are builders. Today, they're rebuilding.
We've called several of our vendors, and they've all donated material, and we're donating material.
Before anyone can build anything, they have to clean up, sorting out memories from debris.
But it won't be easy. Not only are whole homes in shards, some of the pieces aren't even in the right place. This is Mark and Vera Samora's mattress, but they don't live here. They live across the way. Last night during the storm, they rode it 100 feet like a magic carpet out of harm's way.
He just grabbed me and we just held on tight and said, I love you, I love you, because we thought we were going to die. And we managed to stand up and started running, trying to find another house.
Today, volunteers look for other houses to clean up.
Just came by and asked if they needed help. As simple as that. There's plenty to do.
Plenty of landscape to turn into firewood, made a little easier by donations. Leslie Boney, WRAL-TV News, Raleigh.
It seems even too cruel to comprehend, but police tonight are fighting a battle with looters. And Drew Griffin has a live report in the Hampton Oaks subdivision, where, Drew, we understand that police are beefing up patrols out there already.
They are, as you can see. Officers are checking everyone who comes in. They will check the car and make sure the person lives here. It does seem cruel, Charlie, but so far this evening, as of this evening, 16 people have been arrested for looting. Nine of those arrested appeared in Wake County Court today, where bonds were set at $1,500 to $5,000 each. The arrested coming as far away as Garner and Wake Forest to try and steal from the rubble, and police are beefing up their patrols to stop them.
His police patrols and staffing in that area. I understand that Sheriff Baker has also stepped up some of his patrols in the area. We put on some all-night patrols with the highway patrol. We had six cars in the area where we normally don't have anybody. And so the police patrols are increasing. I understand that they're also using high-intensity lights around the businesses. And I think they're having some success in keeping it down.
Now, to stop the looting, police this afternoon cordoned off a lot of those neighborhoods that were damaged and are, again, checking IDs in and out, also checking the workers who are coming in and out of that. Now, you can expect even tighter control tonight, and as you can see, the officers, we've had several police cruising through this neighborhood, not only cruising through, but blocking at the gates to make sure that nobody is in here who doesn't need to be, and of course, there's no reason to be in here. Charlie, we want to remind everyone that those arrested, the 16 arrested, are charged with looting and trespassing in an emergency felony that carries a possible total of 7 years in prison. Charlie?
Okay, Drew, thank you very much. A Franklin County church is trying to pick up the pieces following the tornadoes. The storm leveled a Moriah Baptist Church in Bunn Monday morning as the twister swept through that county. Other than a few church pews, nothing is left of the small rural church. Town officials say cleanup efforts are underway. The storm also wiped out several Franklin County homes, leaving dozens of people homeless.
As those hit by the tornadoes begin to rebuild, there are those who must begin picking up the pieces of their lives without a loved one. Two Wake County children died in yesterday's tornadoes. Funeral services for both of them are scheduled for Wednesday. A service for 9-year-old Janet Barnes is scheduled for 2:30 at First Baptist Church in Raleigh. Janet attended Lynn Road School. A service for 12-year-old Pete Fulgham has been set for 10 a.m. at St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church. funeral services have not been scheduled for two Nash County victims. For many children involved in the tornado, there is more than a loss of homes or belongings. Many have been stripped of their sense of security and feelings of safety. Medical Beat reporter Denise Boyer found today that parents play a crucial role in helping kids cope.
11-year-old Britlin Gorge went back to her tornado-trampled bedroom for the first time today.
This is your room.
Yeah, this is my room. What's left of it?
She found her mattress tossed on end, the blinds twisted in knots and glass everywhere. Sights that were Monday's nightmare.
I just want to cry. I mean, you see the whole house and you see that you lost everything almost. We got almost our furniture downstairs, which is much more than everybody else got. But it's just, you feel like, you know, you don't have anything.
Britlin, like most young tornado victims, has new fears. Hers is the night.
I can't sleep. I keep thinking every time I go to sleep something's going to happen.
Her neighbor, 14-year-old Ben McNeil, is angry. Angry he lost 5 years of artwork and more. It's the loss and limbo that gets to him.
Still trying to put the things together. I haven't been able to get in my room. That's been kind of hard because most stuff that I really wanted to salvage from here has been collapsed into our den.
Whether directly affected or watching friends victimized by the tornado, children will need help working through this tragedy. Linwood School psychologist Lori Church says, look for a change in behavior and deal with feelings.
Encourage them to talk. Many parents may feel like they're going to say the wrong thing. The most important thing is to listen to their child. Ask them what they've been talking about at school. Encourage them to talk about their feelings.
For Ben, the ordeal really won't be over until life returns to normal. Denise Boyer, WRAL-TV News, Raleigh.
There's been such an outpouring of support from the community, the Salvation Army now says it has enough clothing and enough food for the victims. Today, our own WRAL-FM radio team has been loading up the donated goods. The donations have been coming in from all across the Triangle and across the state. The Salvation Army now says victims need money to rebuild their lives. If you would like to send a check to the Salvation Army, make it payable to the Salvation Army Tornado Assistance. The address is Post Office Box 27452 Raleigh. The zip code is 27611. You can still donate any goods that you have. WRAL-TV has teamed up with Howard, Perry, and Walston offices and the Catholic Ministries. You can drop off your donations to any Howard, Perry, and Walston locations or the following churches. And more importantly, if you know someone who is in need of help but cannot use a telephone, please have them call the Catholic Parish Outreach Center between 10 a.m. and 3 p.m. Dial for them, and it's 834-9680. Still to come on WRAL-TV News, it's beginning to feel a lot like Christmas, and Bob will be here with the wintry weather details. Joins us, and he just has some new information.
Just talked to Ben Woods at the National Weather Service office, and their flying evaluation team just landed on the ground and confirmed that it was a single tornado that went a distance of about 33 miles from Wake County all the way up to Halifax County. You know, moving up and coming back and touching down and then moving back up again. Now, what Charlie said a little bit a while ago is that cold air is on the way, and there's no question about that, as Tommy would say. Well, let's get into the stats today and show you what we have for you. The high today was 54. Last night's low, 31. There was some frost around last night. Currently, it is 46 degrees. The humidity at 45%. Pressure high and steady at 30-31. Very light winds, actually calm, and some pretty heavy fluctuations in the lake. Carr went down slightly, but Jordan, Falls, and Gaston all went up at least 3 to 4 tenths of a foot. We move into what's happening as far as our surface weather chart is concerned, and a cold front out to sea and gone, high pressure right on top of us, another cold front on the way, and this is the cold air behind it that will be in here sometime on Thursday. A trough of low pressure is expected to form along the coast, and this is going to enhance the chances of showers, but I just think a very slight chance. Let's put all of this in motion from early in the morning. And we can see the cloud cover and everything starting to build back and start to move closer to us. And as we go ahead now towards midweek, we'll call it tomorrow evening, this is what it's going to look like. The basic cold air is going to be right there, but that trough of low pressure with a little frontal system and a low forming off the coast is giving us a pretty good shot at maybe getting some scattered showers, especially down in eastern North Carolina. Now, one thing for sure, it is cold air behind the front. And as we take a look for the jet stream on Friday, the warm air, for a change, will be back to our west. And as the stream dips down over top of us, it is going to pull this cold Canadian air down on top of us. And so that's what we're going to see, and we're going to show you in a moment just how cold it is going to be. Chilly, if you prefer. Currently 41 at Asheville. We're at 46. There's not a lot of difference in the temperatures, except it is quite cool out at Hatteras, 39, a warm, pleasant 50 over in Charlotte. Clear skies this evening as temperatures begin to move on downward, and we said cool tonight, 28 degrees we anticipate. Fairly light winds tomorrow morning, partly cloudy. Not much happening tomorrow, except maybe a shower late in the afternoon. We'll begin to see the clouds on the increase in advance of the system. 56 tomorrow for the high. Variably cloudy. If we do have some showers tomorrow night, they should end. Now, on the extended, and look at how chilly it is going to be. Wednesday, we reviewed already for you, and then Thursday and Friday, only in the mid-40s? Whew, ridiculous. But I guess it is getting pretty close to winter. And then a fairly nice warming trend on in the Saturday. I say fairly nice, get back up in the 50s, 58 degrees by Sunday, and that in itself is pretty good news. Here is our young, whoop, what happened there? Here's our youngster's picture. Melinda Thompson from Roanoke Rapids said, let it be warm. Well, I'm trying to think so, but I don't know. All right.
From our Department of Crime Control and Public Safety, they have sent out assessment teams, as you know, and we have the very latest figures for everybody tonight. The tornado damage assessments went higher than expected, and here are the latest numbers. $75 million damage in Wake County. $100 million damage for the entire state. 520 homes were destroyed. 1,234 homes were damaged. 41 businesses destroyed. 157 injuries. And as we reported yesterday, 4 deaths. And tonight, there are 848 people who remain homeless.
Devastating.
It sure is, and we'll be back with more news in just a moment.
State law enforcement agents say it is a clear case of an elected official accepting a bribe. But some close friends of a Morrisville town commissioner, Dolores Scott, don't believe it. They say Scott must have been set up. Tim Kent has the latest.
Law enforcement officials received a tip that Morrisville town commissioner, Dolores Scott, was susceptible to taking a bribe. An undercover FBI agent says he gave Scott $55,000 in exchange for political promises.
Court documents say Scott accepted the bribe in relation to this property here, 51 acres of land currently under consideration for rezoning. The FBI claims that Scott took the money after promising her official support.
Just inside the Morrisville town limits, Scott lives in this modest home. She's a longtime resident of the closely knit Shiloh community. Friends and neighbors of the accused commissioner say the bribery charge doesn't sound like the public servant they admire.
No. There's no doubt about it. It really, I was flabbergasted to learn of such thing has, so they say, has happened. And I really just can't believe it.
Scott, who is one of 5 elected members of the town commission, would have no comment today following a court appearance. Tim Kemp, WRAL-TV News, Raleigh.
All right. Time to turn to basketball on a good old Tuesday.
Happy faces at North Carolina State. Happy faces at North Carolina. And we're going to talk about a couple of basketball successes when we... Akron came to Raleigh eager to succeed. The Zips, you see, missed out on a bid to the NCAA tournament last year, even though they won more than 20 games. Akron figured to get a bid this year, NC State was the type of team it needed to defeat. Well, for 20 minutes last night, Akron matches the Wolfpack basket for basket. Eric McLaughlin, fine player, gets 22 points. But in the second half, State, ahead just 2 at intermission, goes to work. The guards go to work. Corsiani penetrates, Monroe scores. Chris passes, Rodney shoots. 16 assists for Corsiani, 22 points, Rodney Monroe State by 10.
This is a great 20. Win for us, you know. After losing our 2 exhibition games, you know, we were very hungry for a win.
we blew Columbia out, and we knew Akron was a much better team, and we wanted to just come in and concentrate on Akron, and we did a good job.
State 87-67. The Wolfpack's Avi Lester also does a good job. Career high, 22 points. The Wolfpack now will play SMU Saturday on the road. Then State will take a 2.5-week break for exams. North Carolina runs its record to 4-1 with a victory over a pretty good Stanford team. The Tar Heels continue to get good play from King Rice, which means they get better play from Jeff Lebo. Rick Sullivan has more.
Carolina looked pretty good last night, and sophomore guard King Rice had a lot to do with it, dishing out 8 assists.
Well, I'm trying not to be flashy. I just want to get the job done, you know, and if I get in there and it looks exciting, then, you know, that's good also.
He's doing a great job. He's handling the ball. He really penetrated well in the second half and dished off, you know. And I think that that was a key to our little spurt there in the second half was his play.
Jeff Lebo benefits when Rice plays well. Lebo gets the chance to play number two guard more often.
Well, it's fun to play both positions. Don't want to be classified as just as a point guard or a two guard. I just consider myself as a guard, and I play both positions. And it's fun when, you know, you see King come in and play. I get to go and play a little bit of different position and go back to the one. So I constantly got to be thinking out there, and I like to do that.
The Tar Heels have a big weekend coming up in Charlotte, a four-team tournament, all four of the teams in the top 20. Rick Sullivan, WRAL-TV Sports.
North Carolina is playing one of the better December schedules of any team in the country. This week, the Tar Heels in that Tournament of Champions Rick talked about will play against number 11, Arizona, and then they'll play either Missouri or Temple. We'll have those games from Charlotte here on TV5 Friday and Saturday. Wake Forest suffers its first loss of the basketball season. The Deacons last night jumped to a 7-0 lead against Richmond. Good bucket here. But the Spiders say, hey, we've been to the NCAA tournament. We know we can come back. Patient Richmond wears down Wake, 74-61.
Got to give Richmond a lot of credit. They played extremely well. They made almost every shot they had to make. And, you know, they executed their game plan very well.
And former Hillsborough Orange star Eric English among the stars for the Spiders. Remember that Loyola Marymount team last year that set all those scoring records before losing to Carolina in the NCAA tournament? Loyola Marymount is back again. Yes, they have tied an old NCAA record by scoring 164 points in a single game. UNLV had held the mark alone since 1976. Also, Azusa Pacific, the team that Loyola Marymount beat, set an NCAA record. Most points scored by a losing team. They scored 136 points and still lost by 28. We begin week number four of the NBA season, and the Charlotte Hornets continue to make their mark on the league. Small marks, but marks just the same. The Hornets lead the league, the NBA, in attendance, and that is no small feat. The Hornets are averaging more than 22,000 per game. The Hornets also have the best record compiled by an expansion team. They are 2-10. Miami has yet to win a game. Miami's in Charlotte tonight, so one of those two expansion teams will get another win. And now something you don't see much. The Houston Rockets have filed a complaint with the NBA office asking that referees not call so many fouls on Hakeem Olajuwon. The Rockets say, okay, yeah, we know Hakeem used to commit a lot of fouls, but he's calmed down. The Rockets think Olajuwon's hot-tempered reputation from his early days is causing him to get fouls he doesn't deserve.
All right, Bob.
Adele, you deserve your reputation. You've been good.
Thanks, Bob. I'm going to miss all you.
Firemen are mopping up from a fire at the textile plant just outside of Fayetteville on Ramsey Street. Fire officials report the fire was contained to a section of the building. It started about an hour ago from what was believed to be an exhaust motor. We have some film crews on the scene. We'll have pictures for you tonight at 11 o'clock. With looters coming in from all over, law enforcement officers are stepping up their efforts to secure damaged areas tonight at 11. We'll go out on patrol with police as they try to stop this. Also tonight, they've lost their church to a tornado. How that damage is done, the members of the Asbury Methodist Church get together. All those stories coming up tonight at 11 o'clock. Now, I have the sad duty, and we hate to do this, to say goodbye to Adele Arakawa. We had hoped the day wouldn't come, but it is here. And so we will miss her. We're very proud of her. She's one of the best anchors in the country and is going to the big city of Chicago. And we have prepared a special little goodbye, so let's just watch that.
All right. Durham City Council passed stage 3 of the water conservation ordinance, putting into effect the...
And Adele's here with her family, and Adele, we just wish you the very best. We're very proud of you.
I really don't have words to say, Charlie. It's a hard thing to leave. It really is. And a lot of people haven't seen Travis since he was a baby.
That's right. But Travis was born here.
We can't say
enough. I'll miss seeing him every Friday night. Barry, goodbye.
Bye.
Good night.
This is the CBS Evening News. Dan Rather reporting.